people get seated, I want to first welcome you all to Eureka College. This is a remarkable crowd, and we are extremely excited both to have Dr. Grandin here and to have so many visitors from the community to join us for this evening. I do want to thank the Eureka College students who are exhibiting servant leadership by having all given up their seats so that we could bring more people into the community. Thank you very much. And I think, as one person put it coming in, this certainly demonstrates the need. My name is Phil Acree Cavalier, and I'm the provost and dean of the college here at Eureka. And we're very honored this evening to have with us Dr. Temple Grandin, an internationally recognized and sought-after thought leader in animal science and autism. While many people only dream of becoming a leading voice in one field during their lives, Dr. Grandin has become a leading voice in two. She has spent her career recasting the way that we understand and interact with both animals and people with autism, and she has created a remarkable body of writing that speaks to experts and to lay people. She has helped us see the animal world through an animal's eyes and has shown us that we can design machines based on principles of human caring and empathy. In a passage describing her first day using a new piece of cattle equipment she had designed, Dr. Grandin writes, quote, "Through the machine, I reached out and held the animal. When I held his head in the yoke, I imagined placing my hands on his forehead and under his chin and gently easing him into position. Body boundaries seemed to disappear, and I had no awareness of pushing the levers. The rear pusher gate and head yoke became extensions of my hands." Dr. Grandin has also shown us how an autistic brain encounters the world. Describing her own mental world, she says, quote, "My mind works just like an internet search engine that has been set to access only images. The more pictures I have stored in the internet inside my brain, the more templates I have of how to act in a new situation." Through her work and in her writing, Dr. Grandin shows us that autism gives her gifts of thinking and seeing differently that have had profoundly positive impact on the world around her. Her impact and influence have been recognized by many organizations over the last 20 years. In 2010, Time magazine recognized Dr. Grandin's impact by naming her as one of the 100 most influential people in the world. In 2004, she was named one of the 40 most influential people in the beef industry, and in 2009, she was inducted into the Meat Industry Hall of Fame. She has received honorary degrees from Duke University, McGill, University of Illinois, Arizona State, and her alma mater, Franklin Pierce College. She has appeared on 60 Minutes, 2020, Larry King Live, and National Public Radio, been featured in the New York Times, Forbes, U.S. News and World Reports, and People Magazine, and given a TED Talk in 2010. She has authored 9 books, numerous book chapters, and hundreds of articles in academic journals and trade magazines. And she's currently professor of animal science at Colorado State University. Please join me in welcoming a brilliant thinker, teacher, and writer, Dr. Temple Grandin.
Thank you for that absolutely beautiful introduction. I've got laryngitis. I'm trying to get over a cold, so you have to bear with me on that. A little bit of coughing. They just brought me some hot tea here to drink. That's going to help me to get through it. And I said, bring it to me. It was nice and fresh and hot because my throat's really going to need it. Well, what I want to do is start out talking about what the autism spectrum is. When I was a little kid, I had the full-blown symptoms of autism, no language until age 4. And I was really lucky to get really good educational intervention. I cannot emphasize enough. If you've got 2-year-olds, 3-year-olds, 4-year-olds that don't know how to talk, I don't care what the diagnosis is, the worst thing you could do with those kids is nothing. You got to start working with those kids lots of hours, 20 or 30 hours a week of one-on-one instruction with different teachers. You know, and they need to be interacting with real live people at this age, not electronics. You know, little ones, let's keep the electronics away. unless they're involved in an interactive activity with a live, a real person. Okay, now the thing is, autism is a continuum. When does quirky and nerdy and socially awkward become mild autism? There's no black and white dividing line. It isn't like having tuberculosis, you have it or you don't. It's a continuum of traits. In the family histories of people with bipolar, you have more creative careers. Family histories of people with autism, you've got more technical careers. You know, after all, half of Silicon Valley has got a little bit of autism. I was just out at the Googleplex. That's a really fun place. And that's where all the happy Aspies go. Lots of free food and lots of exercise on pastel-colored bikes. But you know how they keep them slender on all that free food? The desserts are only this big. I got to eat in the famous Googleplex cafeteria. It's really good, but the brownies are only that big. And that's how they keep them from getting too fat. And everybody looked really good. You see, the thing is, one of the things I like to do is I like to bust silos. You know, people get in their own silos where they just communicate with themselves. I like to do autism conferences. I like to do things out at Silicon Valley. I like to do some gifted conferences. And then, of course, I do all my stuff with meatpacking plants. And I kind of see different iterations of autism in those different places. I can go to a meatpacking plant, and there's an old hippie that runs the maintenance shop, and I know that he's on the spectrum. He's my age. Then I go to an autism meeting, and it's a little 9-year-old kid that's coming up to me. All he wants to do is talk about autism. I'd rather have him talk about his science project. Then I go to the gifted meeting, and I see that same little kid, but he got a gifted label instead of an autism label. And then, of course, you go to Silicon Valley, and they avoid the labels. And the thing I find is that there's very little overlap between the worlds. Because if you check out the book tables, you only have about 5% overlap between an autism book table and a gifted book table. But a lot of the same kids are there, especially when you're on the high end of the spectrum. Another problem you have with autism is this huge, huge spectrum. And it's just turned into a bigger mess now that they've changed the diagnosis. And let's just ask some questions here. Little Albert, no language until age 3. Like to line up blocks. What would happen to little Albert in today's school system? How many powerful antipsychotic drugs would he be getting fat on? And there's way too many powerful drugs given out to little kids. It's totally disgusting. There is a place for medication. I take some medication. Antidepressants for anxiety. A lot of us visual thinkers get a lot of anxiety. A little dab of Prozac or Zoloft can sometimes really do some good. How about little Stevie here? Little Stevie, a weird loner. He brought snakes to school and turned them loose. And he was such a filthy, dirty hippie that when he worked for Atari, they made him come in at night because he was such a slob. And when I gave this talk at the Google Complex, I showed these pictures and I said, but I'm not going to talk about all the live ones that are running around all around here. You know who they are. And I don't mention the live ones. I just talk about the dead ones. That's it. Now, the problem that we've got with the autism spectrum is it's not precise. It's a behavioral profile. And in my new book, The Autistic Brain, I thought we were going to have some copies here tonight, and they brought one of my other really good books, The Way I See It. But in my Autistic Brain book, I go through the history of the diagnosis. Now, I know it had changed over the years, but it was kind of shocking to lay it all out and see just how much it had changed. And nobody is changing the diagnosis of tuberculosis. That stays the same. The problem that we've got with DSM diagnoses is maybe they're half science, and the other half is people squabbling around conference room tables with some really, really intense squabbling. Don't get locked into these labels. I'm kind of appalled at how much people get trapped by the labels. And kids become their labels, especially some of these kids on the milder end of the spectrum. I was really happy today while everybody was waiting in line out there to meet some young people on the autism spectrum that have got good jobs. Because this is one of my big concerns. Kids are not learning enough job skills. I went to school with kids that I know are on the autism spectrum. And, you know, they're quirky and nerdy. Well, in the 50s, boy, they pounded those social skills in. And I think that really helped. Okay, let's go through the history. Okay, in 1943-50, they thought it was all psychological, refrigerator mothers, all that kind of garbage. It was all, you know, psychological. You know, and then they were mixing it up with schizophrenia. I mean, you're talking about a real mess here. Then in 1980, they actually came out with a label that actually made some sense. You had to have speech delay and onset before 30 months. That would have been me. Then in 1987, they went and added PDD-NOS, pervasive developmental disorder not otherwise specified. I don't know what that means. And then in 1994, they added Asperger syndrome. So now you could be on the autism spectrum with no speech delay. So autism had speech delay, Asperger had no speech delay. Now in 2013, they really made a mess. They got rid of all of the speech delay stuff. Everything's all blobbed together into one big sloppy spectrum. I don't think that's what they intended. I think they intended the Asperger kids to become social communication disorder. But nobody's going to get that diagnosis because nobody funds services for that. So you're getting a kid that's like Steve Jobs Jr. labeled autism, and that's getting put in the same basket with somebody that has much more handicaps. When the kids are little, they all need that early intervention. But then they kind of merge off into different groups. And don't get locked into labels. I like silo busting. It's really, really cool to go to the Googleplex and then come back here. And I see kids there. I talked to one, well, of course, when they're in their 20s, they're kids, but I talked to one programming guy, and he told me that he had face blindness. Well, that's one of the main symptoms in autism. You know, they don't like the A word. They get worried. I'm getting worried on some of these smart kids, on the quirky kind of kids that are having trouble in school, getting these labels. And one of the worst things the schools have done, and I don't think they've done it here in Peoria, but they've done it in other parts of the country, is taking out all the skilled trades classes. You know, cooking, sewing, woodworking, art. We have a huge shortage of diesel mechanics. Maybe not around here with Caterpillar, but boy, you get away from here. There's a huge, huge, huge shortage. And if I hadn't had things like art when I was a kid, I would have gone nowhere. Art and sewing, that's what made school worthwhile. And I know people in the meat industry that, well, they do metal fabrication. I know they're on the spectrum. They were the kids that had all kinds of trouble in school. And they were saved by welding class. And you know, those, a lot of those are good jobs. Maybe about 25% of the kids that are like really messed up in high school, a skilled trade would be where they need to go. Not all of them. There's some where that's not appropriate, but some of the ones like me, it was appropriate. Okay, genetics. Autism has a really strong genetic basis. It's a real complicated genetics. Lots of little variations in the code. It's not simple. It's not the simple stuff you learn in biology about Mendel. Now, the thing is, only 2% of your genome actually makes you or makes an animal. What's the rest of the DNA do? When I was going to the University of Illinois in the 80s, working on my PhD, they used to call it junk DNA. I never believed that. It's now called non-coding or regulatory DNA. Well, it's the gene's operating system. What do you think tells the coding DNA what to do? Well, there's only one little problem. Nobody knows how it works. Now, when you take the genome and you fold it all up, coding DNA smushes up against non-coding DNA in some kind of complex mathematical pattern. Well, this is where some Asperger guy will figure this out. We gotta learn how the operating system works. But it's a complicated thing. Now, I like to look at personality differences, sort of like a music mixing board. You know, you can dial up different traits. Anxiety, dial it up, dial it down. The tendency to want to do, like, you know, extreme sports, that sort of thing. You can dial up, dial it down. Some people are visual thinkers like me. Some people are mathematical thinkers. You know, these traits can be adjusted. You know, there's a point where being socially awkward and geeky is just part of normal variation in personality. You know, at what point does something become an abnormality? You know, somebody has got ADHD, they're constantly searching. I was talking to an airline pilot just the other day. A little ADHD is good because they constantly scan. I've actually tried flying a plane, and I was like locked onto this instrument, and I wasn't looking out the window. That is not very, very good. You see, you've got to be looking around at different things. Well, I don't think being a pilot I would not be suitable for that. Now, one of the things I'm good at is designing things. My ability in art was always encouraged. You see, I think completely in pictures. When I design something in my mind, I see it. This is one of my curved cattle handling facilities. As the cattle come around the bend, they think they're going back to where they come from. It's using animal behavior. Now, I used to think that everybody thought in pictures. I didn't know my thinking was different. Until I started asking people, think about a church steeple, how does it come into your mind? And I was shocked to find out that a lot of people get this vague, pointy thing. But you see, for me, there is no generalized one. There's only specific ones. The normal mind that thinks in words overgeneralizes. I just was doing a talk today in an education class, and there's a tendency to go, oh, the kid has autism. What do you do for kids with autism in the classroom? Okay, the little ones, it's lots of early intervention. But you got a seven-year-old, well, what does he do? What kind of problem does he have? Can he read? Can he do math? Is he fidgeting? Is he running around the room? Is he kicking and screaming? You know, what is he doing? I've got to have a lot more information. And I was talking to the students today, and they said they had this six-year-old, and he wouldn't share his toys with another kid. I said, we got to teach this kid how to share. And they said he was just taking toys away from the other kid. And we had talked for about 3 minutes, and then I find out the other kid's a tiny baby. Wait a minute, that really changes things. You know, I need to know that up front. You see, that's that tendency to overgeneralize and not get all the information. Now, I used to joke around that I had a huge internet circuit going deep into my visual cortex. You know, it turns out I've got a really big circuit there for visual thinking. And here's one of my drawings. One of the things I learned very early on is when you're a weird geek, I had to learn to sell my work rather than myself. You know, when I'd show people my drawings, and then they would take me seriously. Okay, if your kid's good at art, get the artwork on the phone where you can show it to people. You know, you've got, and this is a great projector. I want to commend the college here on having a really nice projector because sometimes they really have a horrible one. But that shows the drawing off really nicely. You know, people didn't want to talk to me. I was weird. But when I showed them my drawings, then I got respect. Now, we need to start teaching work skills around age 12. And I'm going to call it paper route substitutes. And volunteer work does count. They could work at the farmer's market. They could set up the chairs every weekend in church and put the chairs away. When I was 15, I was cleaning horse stalls. When I was 13, my mother got me a little sewing job. There's a tendency lots of times to overprotect these kids. What you got to do is stretch them. She had a really good instinct of how to push me just slightly out of my comfort zone. But remember, no surprises. Okay, let's say we're going to change classrooms. Well, don't just come into school and say, okay, we're going to change classrooms today. Let's give some warning. But you've got to stretch. When I was 15, I was afraid to go to my aunt's ranch. And my mother said, you have a choice. You can go for a week or all summer, but not going, that's not going to be a choice. Again, we got to stretch. And I went out to my aunt's ranch, and I absolutely loved it. I wouldn't have gone into the cattle industry if I hadn't gone to my aunt's ranch. Now, the blue part on that drawing, on that brain scan, is cerebral spinal fluid. My math department's pretty well trashed out there. And I'm rather concerned today about all the emphasis on algebra. So how did I get through college? Well, I got to thank the educational fad of 1967 and 68. And the required class was finite math, probability matrices, and statistics. And I could do that with a lot of tutoring. Yeah, I think there's some people who are going the math route and the algebra route's the way to go, but not for me. Kinds of things that I did with hydraulic equipment, I didn't have to have algebra for that. I had the Womack machine books, and they were full of tables. They were really, really helpful. Now, when I was in college, I had access to the same computer that Bill Gates had access to, the 1968 IBM teletype. He could program it, I couldn't. You know, Malcolm Gladwell says, if everybody has enough access to teaching and enough practice, you can do anything. Well, when you get it on extreme ends of the spectrum, I don't think that's true. I wanted to program the computer, but I just couldn't do it. I also couldn't get to the expert level in skiing, no matter how hard I tried. Just didn't have enough balance. What we need to be doing is working on what the kid's good at. You know, my design career was based on art. And oftentimes you get these kids and all they want to do is do the same anime character over and over again. Well, let's broaden it out. Let's do his car. Let's do his house. Broaden those fixations out. Use those fixations to motivate. Now, this is one of my most important slides. You got a lot of kids that get a label, and the problem is, in most school systems, in order to get any kind of service, you got to get a label now. That's got good things, it's got bad things. But I'm getting really worried about some of these fully verbal kids ending up on Social Security, addicted to video games. That's just ridiculous. And then I go to the meatpacking plant, and they're working in the maintenance department. And then I go to the Googleplex, and they run the place. So it's I really like this jumping from silo to silo. And a really cool place I got to go to was JPL. They made the Mars lander. That was like beyond super cool. Okay, I am a photorealistic visual thinker. Everything I think about is a photorealistic picture. So I form concepts by taking specific images and I put them into categories. That's bottom-up thinking. Another kind of thinker is the pattern thinker. This is your mathematician. See, in your brain, you have circuits for where is something. That's the mathematician. The other kind of circuit I have is really intense. What is something? And some of these math thinkers, they're bad at reading. And I've heard some very bad situations where they put the kid in special ed and he's not allowed to move ahead in math. That's wrong. If that fourth grader can do college math, you bring a college math book into the classroom and let him do a college math book. Then you got the guy that's the verbal fact thinker. They know everything about history or some favorite subject. Some of these kids are good at writing. Now the thing is, they've got to learn how to use these skills to do tasks that other people want. Also, they've got to be taught turn-taking. That was taught to me when I was young with board games. A lot of these kids are poor sports, sore losers. I was all of those things. And I had to learn how to take turns. And I got in trouble for being a sore loser. That was not all right. Cheating at games, that was not allowed. I can remember, we used the Parcheesi board, and I slid a pair of six dice into the cup and slid them out. It was made very, very clear that was cheating, and that was not okay. And then some kids are an auditory learner. And then when it comes to reading, you get an argument about phonics, a whole word, teach both. I was a phonics learner, but there's other kids that are a whole word learner, and you're going to mess them up with phonics. You need to do both. Now there's evidence, because now today we have to have scientific evidence. And when I was working on the autistic brain book, I found these great studies that backed up my observations about the object visual thinker, me, and the mathematical thinker. There really are these different thinkers, and there's brain scan research that shows that this is true. I was very happy to see these studies. I was kind of disappointed that they were 10 years old. You know, I think sometimes they get a little much too much PC correctness that everybody's totally the same. Yeah, there's a wide range of skills, and there's a lot of plasticity here in the middle, and you can move it back and forth. But you're not going to make me an algebra specialist. That's just not going to work. Now, just to show you, there's two ways to do the math, the verbal way and the visual spatial way. And there's some people go, well, this kid doesn't show his work. I don't think you get it through his head. He thinks differently. Now, I would take some precautions against cheating and strip him of electronics, make sure he can do it with no electronics, and then realize he thinks differently. I want to give you a glimpse into a mind that's not my mind. That praying mantis is made out of a single sheet of folded paper. No cut, no tape. What you see in the background is the folding pattern. Now, that's not my mind. It's like, wow, that's the mathematician's mind. And there are some beautiful little origami stars some kids gave to me, and then I got that dragon off the internet. That was pretty cool. There's another one of my drawings. I always like to show those off. Okay, now Jessie Parks is somebody that's more of a medium level in autism. She's verbal, but much more autistic. And this is beautiful artwork that she sells professionally. Well, you know, her fixation used to be electric blanket controls. And nobody wants pictures of that. You know, so you're going to have to work with them to get them to draw stuff that people want. And they don't want the Godiva chocolate signs, and they don't want the Merrill Lynch signs either. Those are pretty bad, too. And here's some beautiful work done by another person on the spectrum. And his mother was showing his work at autism conferences, and I go, wait a minute, his work's good enough to go professional. You know, this is where we're going to have to do some silo busting. I think some of the people that work with autism ought to go out and visit some of the machine shops and stuff around here, because I'm sure you're going to find some of your best machinists over there at Caterpillar or on the Spectrum. Now, I've never even been in a Caterpillar plant, but I've been in enough of those kind of places that sometimes this kid that's a problem student in high school, he's going to be some of your best mechanics, best people with equipment. Okay. All right, all you STEM fanatics and all your algebra fanatics, I'm going to give you a reason why you better not screen the people like me out. I'm getting very concerned with all the algebra craziness right now that I'll be screened out. And what you see there is something you don't want to get very close to. That is the remains of the Fukushima nuclear power plant. It is still leaking radioactivity in the ocean. And when I found out why this happened, I couldn't believe it. They made a visual thinking mistake I would never make. We're going to leave the design of the reactor to the mathematicians. But it's not a very good idea when you live next to the sea to put those super important emergency generators and all that emergency cooling equipment in a non-waterproof basement. Wasn't a really good idea. You know, if they'd bought some waterproof doors from a shipbuilding company, this wouldn't have happened. This is the sort of stuff I was completely capable of designing. There's no way I would make that mistake. You know, when Steve Jobs made the iPhone, he was an artist, not an engineer. The engineers have to make the inside of that phone work. And then when you're thinking about the things that JPL does, okay, why should we fund something like the Mars Lander? Well, you like your cell phone camera, don't you? JPL invented that. And they've also invented a new thing that's really cool, a mass spectrometer this big, the size of a large coffee cup. It can analyze any chemical you put in it, and it'll tell you what's in it. You put dirt in it, it'll tell you what's in it. That's pretty cool. That could be a really useful thing to have. Okay, in my first work with cattle, I noticed that the cattle got scared of a lot of little things that people tended to not notice. Like you got a flag there waving, there'd be a chain hanging down, there'd be reflection, stuff we tended not to notice. It was obvious to me. And when I first started this, I didn't know that other people didn't think visually. Okay, how many people here saw that animal was locked onto that sunbeam like radar? How many people saw that? We got to work on our observation skills. Our observation skills are terrible. Okay, and you're going to have to work with some of these kids that are nonverbal. You got to be a good detective. The first thing you got to do is rule out a painful medical problem. You know, maybe he's got acid reflux. That's big number one. Constipation, yeast infections, earaches, toothaches, things like that. If he's screaming in the middle of Walmart, it's probably sensory overload. Or maybe you go in a certain room and he's screaming. And the reason why he's screaming is he sees a microphone. And sometimes these things make feedback screeching sounds. So then every time he sees a microphone, he's going to have a fit when he sees it. I want you to get away from language. To understand animals and people that are nonverbal, you must get away from verbal language. You've got to enter a sensory world. Now, some people do better, and I showed this to JPL, they did a bit better than you guys did on, see, the cow was looking at the sunbeam. Now, when you look at it now, it's obvious. But the problem is it sometimes the least obvious? It's the most obvious. An animal's world is sensory-based. I want to get you in working with some of these kids that are different. Try to get away from words, and don't get locked into these labels. I get really annoyed when somebody comes up to me and says, well, I work in the classroom, and I got an autistic kid with behavior issues. Well, what does that mean? What did he do? This afternoon we were talking about stuff we found out the behavior issue involved a tiny baby. Well, you're going to deal with that differently than if it, you know, involved another six-year-old. I find the same problem with animal questions. People will say things like, well, my dog is crazy. I said, well, what do you mean your dog's crazy? Now, I'm visualizing things, a cute little poodle jumping on somebody because he's all happy and wagging his tail, or maybe a Rottweiler that rips somebody's hand off. Maybe that's both the dog is crazy. But you see, those are very, very, very difficult, different things. Now, there's evidence that language covers up visual thinking because there's a type of Alzheimer's disease that as language is wrecked, art comes out. There's a new book coming out by a guy who got in a bar fight and all of a sudden became a mathematician. So maybe language is sort of just covering up the inner mathematician. Now, I noticed you had a replica out there of Van Gogh's Starry Night, and when the mathematicians got a hold of this, they found out that he was putting in their turbulent mathematical patterns. I don't think Van Gogh realized he was doing that. This is a really important slide, another really important concept slide. My thinking's bottom up, not top down. And I'm concerned today we have too much top down thinking. We got people in government now that have never done real jobs, come right out of college with a degree in something really awful like public administration. I'm sorry, but you shouldn't be able to get a master's degree in bureaucracy. I just have problems with that. You see, in solving problems, bottom-up thinking, you think of specific examples. Okay, let's say we did something with health care legislation. What would that do to Susie Q that lives in the trailer park? You know, and then you got Jane over here that's a school teacher. You got somebody else who's a retired accountant. You see, again, I'm like looking at them as at specific examples. And then I put them together into categories. Concepts are made out of specific examples placed in categories. Let's say you want to teach a kid a concept like good or bad. Well, you got to just do it with teachable moments. Saying please is being good. Waiting in line quietly is being good. Spitting on the sidewalk is bad. You know, that's kind of abstract. Let's take words like up and down. You need to teach that with a lot of specific examples. You go up the hill, climb up a ladder, plane went up in the air. You need to use 7 or 8 different examples. Teach that concept of up. Everything is learned with specific examples. You have got to reverse the way that you think. You want to understand how these kids think. My thinking is also associative. It's not linear. It's associative. Okay, I put a keyword in. Let's say I'm at the Chicago airport. I'm there all the time. Well, now I'm seeing this ugly black tarp they put up in there. I don't know, maybe it was too hot over the security station or something. You know, make it a sunshade, but they got black tarp, and then they've got this box that looks like something the cat would use for a litter box with a plastic bag in it to catch the drips out of the roof. See, those are some things I'm just seeing from the last trip to O'Hare. And now when I think about this, I can go into an airport category, or I could go into a glass structure category and start going through my database. Well, biosphere in Arizona, the Crystal Palace, the greenhouse at Colorado State, or maybe the Denver airport. How about the Dallas airport? How about Minneapolis-St. Paul? How about the Atlanta airport? And I got this one thing really cool at Atlanta airport. While I'm thinking about that, now I'm my Atlanta airport super coolness. T concourse, T as in Tom, where United is, ugly little concourse. But now they've got a really cool spacesuit exhibit. That was very cool. Like I could get this close to the spacesuits. And you know what? They're all handmade. You know, somebody had a sewing machine and laboriously sewed those spacesuits. You know, that's the kind of things that I find really cool. People making really cool stuff. And I think they went to the moon with that stuff. And then there is an ugly old hangar at LaGuardia that probably has got really, really cool aviation memorabilia in there. That'd be a really great place to explore. Okay, when I asked an astrophysics professor about church steeples, he saw abstract motion of people singing and praying. I go, oh, wow, trippy. He didn't see any steeples at all. Now, cattle are specific. If you train your animal to work with a man on horse, they learn that that's nice and safe. And then they go to the meatpacking plant, see their first man on foot, and you wonder why they're going berserk. It's not because they're scared of getting slaughtered. It's because the man on foot's something totally new. It's a different picture. If you want to see how a beef plant works, you can go on YouTube and look up beef plant video tour of Temple Grandin, and you will see how my center track restrainer system works. But animal thinking is very specific. Man on a horse, think about it, it's a different picture than man on the ground. You need to train them to both. I find that most people have a real hard time categorizing problems. I'm trying to solve a problem with a piece of equipment. Do I have a training issue or something wrong with the equipment? All right, let's say we're dealing with a kid who's nonverbal. Do I have a behavior problem or do I have a biology problem? A biology problem could be a painful medical problem, sensory sensitivity, even people that are fully verbal, they can't remember long strings of verbal information, multitasking, that's biological. Behavior, man, pitch a fit to get out of doing something. Yeah, I've done that. Frustration because I couldn't communicate, so I pitched a fit. You gotta figure out what's motivating it. Or pitch a fit to get attention. I also did that, too. All right, there are the people in the in the control room. I got to sit in his seat. That's the Mohawk guy. I got to meet him, and I'm really terrible about names, but he's got gorgeous red highlights now. I definitely noticed that. And the old hippie there, he's the navigator. You know what? He was a theater major who switched to physics. You know, this just kind of shows how what you major in, what you start in majoring in isn't what you become. Because I was originally a psych major, and I switched over to animal science. Now, the thing is, you got to have to deal with anger. When I was in the ninth grade, I got kicked out of school for throwing a book at a girl. And then when I went to special boarding school, I got horseback riding taken away for 2 weeks for fist fight in the cafeteria. And that's when I switched to crying. And I was still absolutely miserable. But some of these boys, if they want to stay out of jail, they need to learn how to cry. Because at good workplaces, they don't even tolerate you. If you put your dukes up and threaten someone, they'll fire you for that. You got to get rid of anger. And if you have a hard time controlling emotion, you can switch it to something else like crying. And I had a lot of social problems in the meatpacking plants, so then I'd go hide in the electrical room because they had a great sign to keep people out of there. I'd just go in there, and then nobody even knew I was in there. I wouldn't go in the restroom. But you got to control the anger stuff. Boy, especially today. Now, I found that looking at things was more interesting than looking at people. But if you didn't have people interested in things, you wouldn't have electricity. Tesla, who invented the power plant, would be labeled autistic today. You gotta stretch these kids. We already talked about that. Stretch them just past their comfort zone. And then I had a great science teacher, mentors. And I had people in the cattle industry that helped me. The movie showed a lot of bad people, but they also were good people that helped me, like Jim Uhl, the contractor, who actually seeked me out to have me design jobs. This is where people get attracted to talent. This is why you need to make a portfolio. Okay, you get good at programming, and the right person sees that you can write code really nice, then you can get a job in Silicon Valley. And learning working skills, I cannot emphasize that enough. I'm seeing too many smart, geeky kids graduating from college that can't get jobs. They don't have any working skills. It's just terrible. I also had some entrepreneur skills. When I was getting my master's degree, I went out to the state fair and I painted signs for the carnival. Boy, and I did some really freaky signs, like the Himalayan ice monster. That was like a really stupid thing. A freezer chest full of a wax dummy in a freezer chest. It was supposed to be a Yeti or something like that. I painted a big sign for that. You know, that was taking a little... I just walked up to sign painter and asked for a job. And there's a scene in the movie where I walk up to the editor of the arrangement and I get his card. I actually did that. And what gave me the guts to do that? Because when I was in elementary school, my mother made all of us kids be party hostess and party host. And when she had a party, we had to greet the guests, take their coat, serve them hors d'oeuvres, but that taught important social skills. I'm seeing too many kids that come up to me at a meeting, and the parents are doing the talking when the kid ought to be doing the talking. Kids are also not doing free play, where they have got to negotiate rules. There's starting to be some studies that maybe that's a really bad thing, that kids are not doing free play. My ability in art was always encouraged. Build on the area of strength. Too often we pound away on a deficit, and we don't work on making the area of strength into a career. All right, here's your free classes. Udacity, and then Code Academy. I don't have up there Code Academy. That is free programming classes. You know, you learn those things, you can go places. Now, some people are getting kind of discouraged about the online learning, because only about 4% of the people that took these classes finished them. You know what? I don't think you need to finish them. Because when I went out and I got my Womack machine books on hydraulics and pneumatics, I had 4 books. You know, I read the first one really carefully, and I used the other 3 for reference. But that's all I had to do my work. What they need to do is go back and find out how many people went on Udacity, learned enough programming to do something at work, where it really helped advance them. I'm going to bet you that's a lot of people. You know, because I had no reason to take the entire Womack course. I didn't need it. Okay, but there's all kinds of fabulous stuff online. You know, the thing I'm seeing today is there's all this fabulous stuff online and people aren't using it. I can't believe the emails I get, people ask me these questions, and I gotta go down and Google it. Well, why didn't they Google it? And it took me 30 seconds to Google it. I just typed the words they were asking about, you know, names of drugs or something like that, into Google. Now, this is one of my drawings done in SketchUp. SketchUp is a free program for 3D drawing. This is a great activity, because the only places where I was not bullied and teased in high school were the specialized activities. And for me, that was horseback riding, model rocket club, and electronics. For a lot of kids around here, it could be FFA, it could be 4-H, or it'd be really cool things like MakerBot clubs where you print things on 3D printers. And the thing I like about 3D printers is it now the computer world is interacting with the physical world. And if you don't do it right, it'll print you a pile of goo rather than printing your little thing. You know, it's kind of a fiddly little machine. And when you go on the MakerBot website, it says, warning, requires patience and know-how. You know, you're going to have to work at learning how to use this thing. I was horrified to go on the model rocket site about 2 weeks ago and find out you can buy rockets already made. That is not the point. You have to build your rockets. And that's something you do with the other kids. Here's some other great online science stuff. And when I was not studying in high school, I was doing things like remodeling our Skeeto house. And I was at this boarding school for about 4 years, and the first 3 years I was there, I did zero schoolwork. But boy, did I learn work skills. I think Mr. Patey, the headmaster, kind of had a good instinct there. But I'm seeing too many kids today becoming recluses in their room. That was one place where that was not allowed. When I didn't want to go to movie night, he gave me a choice. I could sit in the audience or I could be the projectionist. But not going was not going to be an option. I had to show up for classes even though I didn't study. I'm seeing too many kids to get anxious and they become recluse. Some of these kids may need to take a little Prozac or something, one of the antidepressants. And if you know somebody that has a lot of anxiety problems, they might want to read Thinking in Pictures and read my chapter called A Believer in Biochemistry, where I describe my experiences with medication. Mentors. I had a fabulous science teacher. You know, there's all kinds of retired people now. You got all kinds of mechanical people, you know, from the Caterpillar plant. You need to tap into these people. And I was really happy to talk to one Asperger guy that's doing machine shop stuff. That's just really great. Now, the skilled trades are not for everybody. The word thinkers, they're not going to like skilled trades. But you got a lot of stuff around here. But if you don't expose kids to that stuff, they're not going to get interested in it. You got to expose them to it. I'm very worried that our educational system is getting off on another fad. And, you know, you're going to leave people like me out. I'm really, really worried about that. But you need me. I'm getting concerned about all this computer stuff. Oh, we're going to have driverless cars and things like that. I'll tell you one thing that car better have. It better have an absolute off switch. When I press this button, it disconnects the battery mechanically. So there's no way that the computer can override it. It just pulls a switch on the battery. Okay, I think taking hands-on classes out of the schools is the worst thing they ever did. The other thing that's bad about taking these classes out is they teach practical problem solving today. We got people going into government now where it's all too abstract. Let's look at some animal issues. Instead of having people that are hands-on trying to fix problems with animals, they all become lawyers and sue stuff. They're not working on how do you fix things. We got to figure out how to actually solve problems. You know, politics, like, totally disgusting. I couldn't believe the stuff that went on with this, you know, closing down bridge lanes. I'm a bipartisan trasher of this stuff. What are these stupid kids that are AIDS thinking about? That you'd shut down bridge lanes and make a traffic jam on purpose. Why would you do something like that? I think that's getting too far away from real world. Okay, here's the things that just absolutely saved me, were the hands-on classes. You know, we need people in this country that can do real things. You know, and get into other parts of the country, we've got shortages. Certified welders for the oil industry, utility workers for the electric wires, diesel mechanics, auto mechanics, real high-end engineers. What's happening to our high-end engineers? They're getting addicted to video games. You know, they're not going into the video game industry. You know, we got to limit the video game playing to about an hour a day. I'm seeing too many quirky kids getting a label and they're not getting challenged. Because I can think back to quirky kids I went to college with. I know they were on the spectrum. And they have good jobs today. Some of them are running companies. You know, how do you have successful employment? Sell your work and not yourself. Also, in working with a boss, I found I had to have very specific outcomes. Like when I was working for the farm and ranchman, all my articles were due on the 15th of the month. There were certain meetings I had to cover, like the Arizona Cattle Feeders, the Arizona Feeders Day, the show and sale results for the livestock show, do a certain amount of feature writing. You know, it was pretty clear what was expected, and I looked at old copies of the magazine to figure that out. And when there's a mistake, the boss needs to just correct it. Like when I showed up at work and I hadn't used deodorant, my boss slammed down the deodorant and said, "You stink, use it." That actually happened. You know, you can't be vague. Being vague doesn't work. Let's say we want to train somebody to be a museum tour guide. Well, you demonstrate the correct distance. You demonstrate the correct greeting. You know, maybe you say to them, "Watch how Susie does it. She does it purpose, does it really right. Well, do it the way Susie does it." You cannot be vague. Absolutely cannot be vague. Now, sensory issues. Sensory issues, they can really be a problem for a lot of people. And they vary from being very serious and debilitating to being nuisances. You can get them along with lots of different labels. Loud sounds hurt my ears. So what can we do to get kids trained to tolerate those sounds? Sometimes they can learn to tolerate them if they initiate the sound. If it's the buzzer on the scoreboard in the gym, they go turn it on, maybe with headphones on, then they can turn it right off. Also, a lot of individuals have trouble hearing hard consonant sounds. Like if someone says rat, cat, or bat, I have to figure that out by context. Obviously, I wouldn't be talking about my pet rat. Well, I might have a pet rat, but I certainly wouldn't have a pet sat. A pet sat, for sure, that's for sure. You know, slow down. Enunciate those hard consonants. And my speech teacher would say to me, "Cup," and then she'd say, "Cup," where she'd slow down, enunciate the hard consonant sounds. Now, there's my circuit for speak what you say. I had a real small one. You see, where there's the abnormality is in the white matter circuits that connect up the inter-office departmental communication. You know, your gray matter goes around the outside of the brain. That's your thinking circuits. That's where the plasticity is. But the whole middle of the brain is a thicket of big cables. So I don't have a very good speak what you say circuit. There is a normal speak what you see. Speak what I see. That's mine. I got a lot of extra bushes there. Those extra bushes may be why I have a language-based visual search engine. But the thing is, if you went out and you scanned 100 people, at what point are extra bushes abnormal? Again, it's not black and white. It's a continuum. Well, now the price I paid for those extra bushes is I had less bandwidth. I had less fibers for speak what I see. So I had trouble getting speech out. Then you got other kids that are echolalic. They yak out all this speech, and they yak out all these movie scripts, but they don't know what they mean. You see, the output's working fine, but the meaning's not hooked up. So you got two kinds of language problems there. Attention shifting slowness. It takes me much longer to shift back and forth between two different things. Like if there's too many distractions around, it tracks my attention, I have a hard time paying attention. You know, some kids, you get what's called clipping. If I say to a child, "Hang up your coat," he might just hear the word coat. So then I need to say, "Tommy, I need to ask you a question or tell you to do something." Then I ask him to hang up the coat. Some individuals, when they go to read, they see the print jiggle on the page. Now, this doesn't solve all reading problems, but I'm finding about one student out of 50 has this problem in my drawing class. They absolutely cannot draw. So what are some simple things you can try? Try printing the homework on different pastel papers, maybe light blue, light gray, tan, light green. Try on some different colored pastel glasses. You know, it'd be pretty stupid not to try this, even if it only had a 1 in 50 chance of working, because it doesn't cost anything to try it. Well, there's my head. Now that is the white matter connector cable, all the inner office communication that's inside my head. Then right here, you can see little tiny fibers that are the little white matter fibers. You can barely see them. See, this is where a lot of the abnormalities are, is these cables that connect up the inter-office communication. That's where a lot of the differences are. And there's my connectome without the head. Now, other scan findings showed that my amygdala, emotion center, was bigger than normal. So it was really high fear. And that was controlled with antidepressant medication. Antidepressants are some of the best drugs for dealing with anxiety, but in very low doses. And I talk about this in detail in my book, Thinking in Pictures, also in the Way I See It book. Okay, what are some accommodations that might be needed? Some individuals can't tolerate the flicker of 60-cycle old flashing fluorescent lights. Some individuals are going to need a quiet place to work. Some people are going to need some breaks to calm down. And again, no sudden surprises. If we're going to be changing something, let's have some notice. And no scratchy clothes. I still cannot tolerate any scratchy clothes against my skin. It just drives me crazy. I already talked about it. It's okay for geeks to cry. And when the space shuttle shut down, they were doing a lot of crying on 60 Minutes. And that's why they had those shops. And I've talked to some of those NASA space scientists, and they're granddads now. And they've got sons and grandsons that are on the spectrum. And they say half the people at NASA probably are on the spectrum. See, this is the thing that concerns me. Okay, it takes a village to raise a child. You know, a lot of these kids are kind of quirky and different. We need to be just figuring out informal things. Like my mother set up a little sewing job with a lady that ran a freelance sewing business. You know, these things can be easy to do. Tap into some retired people to teach a small engine class to junior high school kids. You know what the price of old lawnmowers is? They're free. You know, there's all kinds of stuff like this. Or somebody can come in and teach art or teach cooking or sewing or just all these sorts of things. Now, you have a child with very severe autism. See, this is a problem we have. One end of the spectrum, we kind of got the geeks and the nerds. You know, people, and some of them could go to the Googleplex. And then at the other end, you've got very, very severe that are going to need to live in a supervised living situation. And now the new total muddle of a diagnostic thing we've got now, they're all on the same spectrum, and it's just a real mess. And I don't think that's what they intended, but that's what's happened. And those people need respite. There's a lot of things they need. You know, and the problem is as they grow older, the different individuals on the spectrum need different kinds of services. People need to get out of the silos. The first thing that you got to do is not get locked into the words, autism, dyslexia, ADHD, whatever. Don't get locked into those words. See, being a visual thinker, I see the kids. So I'm going around different conferences and I see the kids. They're specific examples. And there I am with my mother. And she had a really good sense of just how hard to push me, just how much to stretch me. You know, and I'm seeing a lot of kids today that aren't getting stretched enough. And there are some of my books. And what I want to do right now is I want to have plenty of time for questions. Okay, I'm going to pick somebody for questions if nobody has a question. Okay, right there. And then I'll repeat the question. How did the movie change my life? It made it a whole lot busier, that's for sure. I think they did a really super good job with the movie. Emily Gerson Sains, the producer, is the mother of a severely autistic child, and she was the brains behind the whole thing. And it took them 10 years to put the project together because they had to get the right team to know what to do with the story. And I think they did a great job. All my projects are accurate, visual thinking shown accurate. There's things they had to change, but the important stuff is clinical accuracy. It shows autism accurately, and it's sort of like, for me, was going back into the 60s and the 70s time machine. Okay, right here. How old is she? She's 8 years old and nonverbal. Okay, I've got to repeat it for the... Well, she's 8 years old and nonverbal. First of all, she's got to learn just basic skills, dressing, showering, hopefully some cooking, you know, things like that. And you know, try to figure out things that she's good at. You know, sometimes we underestimate these kids. You know, if you're working, you might want to read some of the books. There's a book called The Reason I Jump It's number one on the Amazon autism bestseller list, A Japanese Boy That's Nonverbal. There's Tito's How Can I Talk and My Lips Don't Move. Those are two excellent books. You can really get a sense of what kind of the world that a nonverbal person is living in, with all kinds of sensory jumbling. Anybody that's working with nonverbals past age 5 needs to get those two books, The Reason I Jump, and the other one is called How Can I Talk If My Lips Don't Move, and they're available on Amazon, or you can order them locally. Okay, I'm going to pick, okay, in the back there. To be in high school, you got to make it quick because other people can't hear you. Well, this is a problem. Lots of times people on the spectrum are interested in things that would be considered kind of babyish. What tends to happen on the high school stuff, high school was a big disaster for me. And there's some of these kids where they need to go from being a child to being a grown-up. Because I'll be perfectly honest, socializing with teenagers is not a life skill that I need. It really is not. And I think the biggest thing we got to worry about in the 13-year-old is needs to start learning some work skills. But there's some kids that do great in high school because they get in with a special interest thing. I've talked to parents, well, the kid was in choir and in band, and that was working great. Or he was in a robotics club, or he was in a math club, or some other thing like that where there's a shared interest. What tends to happen in the high schools is either a big disaster, or in some cases it can work out really well. And 13 years old, that's when I had my sewing job 2 afternoons a week. He what? Good. Well, the thing he needs to do about children's movies is let's just enjoy those at home and not at school. And then I remember talking to a parent where this one kid, he really liked Power Rangers, and he wanted to wear a plastic Power Ranger around his neck. Well, put it on your keychain. You can put all kinds of weird junk on your keychain, put the Power Ranger on your keychain, then that's perfectly okay. But around your neck really looks weird. Unless he's a real tiny one and he's on one of those ID card holders, that might be okay. You see, now I'm visualizing that when I see that. Okay, right here.
This is more of a you question, but who was like one of your motivation?
What motivated me? Well, one person was my science teacher, Mr. Carlock, and he was a retired NASA space scientist. He was not an accredited teacher. And he was one example of a creative kind of person, and he ran the Model Rocket Club and, taught really cool science class, got me interested. This is where these mentor teachers can sometimes really, really make a big difference. Because I went from no studying, where in the last year in high school I knuckled down, and then when I went to college, I did not have all the organizational problems that so many kids are having, and problems with things like interrupting classes. Because I kind of learned that, okay, you can ask 2 questions in every class and that's about it. That gets back to the turn-taking thing. The problem I had in college was all the social stuff in the dorm. That was terrible. It wasn't the classes. Okay, right here. So you're getting some self-talking? Well, I used to do self-talking, and the reason why I did it is saying my thoughts out loud helped me to organize them and think. Well, you see, and I could add some places where I could do that, and other places you don't do it. Okay, let's take about 3 more. Okay, right here. Okay, wait a minute. You're starting a new program. Wait a minute. I don't know everything that's going on in your state, so you're going to have to tell me what kind of program you're starting. It's in Peoria. Okay. So it's a new school you're starting for kids with autism. How old are kids? All right, just little kids through 8th grade.
And they are not functioning until
Okay, so in their home school district, it's not working. And the thing I find, you get in all argument about public versus private, I don't even want to hear that. Because what I have found is so much depends upon the particular school and the particular situation. I mean, I travel all around the country, even go in other countries. Oh, one situation, a local public school is wonderful. Another situation is horrible. Another situation, a private school is terrible. So much gets down to the particular people, particular teachers, the principal in that particular school. Those are all factors that are really important. Now, the thing is, let's not just get so generalized as saying, well, they're not working in their school district. That is overgeneralizing. We need to start looking at what kind of problems are these kids having. We got different ages of kids here. What kind of difficulties are they having with the school district? Don't just get into a blanket, well, the school district's bad and it's not working. That's too general. What are the problems? And then we also need to start looking at, well, there's some school districts where things work. What are they doing differently? You see, this is applying some more bottom-up thinking to it. I want to get you thinking in more detail and more bottom-up thinking. Now, the disadvantage of bottom-up thinking is you got to collect a lot of data and see a lot of different things to get these specific examples. Okay, right here. Well, if you're doing well at work, you don't need to tell employers. You know, sometimes it's better to just, you know, talk about some specific need you have, like get me away from fluorescent lights, tell them they give you migraines or something. Or you need a quiet place to work, or you just say to your boss, well, I do so much better when I write down what you want, and let me give you some time to write it down. That's some specific thing, because unfortunately there's still discrimination out there. And you're in a good job and everything's stable. When I do a project meeting, we do a project meeting, and I learned kind of how to run a project meeting. I said, okay, now what does this job got to do? It's got to be this budget. It's got to run this many cattle per hour. Okay, we can't move the railroad tracks. That's too expensive. You know, okay, what are, you know, some of the parameters here? And I write them down, boom, 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 boom. And then I make sure that what I design does that. If you work for, you know, let's say you worked programming. Let's say you worked at Google. Well, if your boss just says, well, why don't you develop some new software, something really vague, that doesn't work. And then, you know, then you say, now, okay, I've got to develop an app for phone that does a certain thing, and it's in this programming language, and it uses this much memory. Okay, that's something specific. You see that? Getting specific outcomes. And the other thing is, the boss, you can sometimes work with your boss not to be so vague. You know, you can't just say to the employee, well, you're too aggressive with customers at the store. That's too vague. So, you know, they've got to just tell you. But if you're doing good in the job, there'd be no reason to tell them. You know, or maybe just tell them something where you need a specific accommodation, like getting away from fluorescent lights. Or I'd have a really horrible time if I had to work in an open plan office. I would not have a very difficult time getting any work done, in serious work where I had to think in an open plan office. Okay, let me take somebody else and I'll come back to you. Okay, how about somebody over here? Okay, right here.
Yes, thank you. My brother and his wife live near Chicago. They have a 14-year-old daughter with tuberous sclerosis.
Tuberous sclerosis?
They have a 13-year-old son who has Asperger's. Have you seen a situation where siblings would suffer similarly like that?
Oh, you can lots of times get, you got to remember it's genetic, and you got lots of little genetic variations. And one of the things that's showing up in Silicon Valley, especially in some of the older companies, they got autism coming out the kazoo. Because what's happening is you're concentrating the traits. Mom and dad are both programmers. That concentrates the traits. And you go to the older companies, I don't think I'll name them, but you know the ones. Old companies have been around for a while. They got autistic grandkids now. And I've given talks at those companies. Well, you've got autism clusters around the tech centers. I've seen that on web page hits.
Have any of your colleagues work exclusively with tuberous sclerosis?
No, tuberous sclerosis is a very specific, you know, abnormality in the brain. And of course, those things, depending on how much those tumors grow, affects, you know, what it's going to do on behavior. Yeah, and that is, you know, you have regular autism, there'd be no abnormalities like that in the brain. Yeah, that's something that's really very different. But autism got a really strong genetic basis. And then there's some other things involved in it, like lack of B vitamins, taking certain drugs early in pregnancy can be a problem, environmental contaminants, especially in very early pregnancy or just prior to conception. Also, you've got to remember the guy has got to be careful about the chemicals too, because the semen gets copied, constantly makes a copy of a copy of a copy, like Xeroxing, Xerox the copy, Xerox the next copy, you copy it, you copy it, you get copying errors. So older parents, especially on the guy, you've got more copying errors. Now that's another issue, so he can't be getting chemicals all over him either. You know, they used to think they just had to protect the pregnant lady. Yes, we got to protect the pregnant lady, but the guy is also fragile too for chemicals, especially the older he gets. What area became self-aware about what, that I had autism? Or, well, I just always knew I was kind of different. You know, when I was very little, they didn't even know what autism was, because that was 1949. I was originally diagnosed as brain damaged. And then the autism label came later, and of course they went into all the psychoanalytic BS, trying to find the psychic injury. That was total malarkey. Well, actually, I had a decent childhood. I mean, my bad problems started in puberty in high school. Large girls' school. You know, girls were no longer interested in projects. See, when I was young, I got along with a lot of kids because I could build things and do art projects, and other kids thought that was cool.
Who was hard to get along with? The people that were on your level?
Well, the worst problems I had was high school, teasing. And the only friends I had were with the shared interests. And this is why I put so much emphasis on things like shared interests, like robotics or 4-H or FFA or Boy Scouts, Girl Scouts. I talked to a man last night that's a truck driver, has got Asperger's. And he, in his town, there was a Boy Scout transportation badge. And that is how he learned truck driving. He drives a dry freight van. He's been doing it for 35 years. You know, and he's on... You know, he's not officially diagnosed. Well, how old are you now?
Now I'm 19.
19, you out of high school? What are you doing now? You work at Olive Garden, you're keeping a job, you'd be congratulated for that. Absolutely congratulated. You know, one of the things that I'm finding here is I'm really happy with the number of people that have got jobs and they've been keeping them. I go to some other places, there's too many guys like you on Social Security playing video games. That's where I really want to scream. And I've talked to a whole bunch of guys about your age. Just tonight I talked to 4 or 5 people that all have jobs. And that is really good. And I'm really glad you're keeping your job. That's just excellent. All right, let's take about 2 more questions and then I'll hang around afterwards and talk to some people. All right, one of the things we need to be doing with seniors in high school is they need to start working. Go on the internet and look up Project Search Autism. Go on and use these keywords, Project Search Autism. And they got a program in Virginia where the whole last year of high school, they set up these internships at a hospital where they're learning really decent jobs like setting up cardiac catheters. Everybody works together to make it work. And they're getting these jobs and keeping these jobs, because they got all this work experience before they graduate from high school. I strongly recommend he's a senior. That's what he needs to be doing. And we got to start thinking about, what's he good at? What could he do for a career? Mechanic? All right, can he start? He's old enough, he should be able to start working in a shop. He's taking auto shop in high school. And does he love auto shop? Has he ever worked in an auto shop? Well, just go grease the skids at some local car dealership. This is where we got to get in there, short-circuit that interview, short-circuit all that crap. And you got to get in there with some car dealership friend of yours, kind of explain the situation and get him a good job. How's he on the anger stuff? Can't throw anything. You throw a wrench, you're gone. You can't do that. But let's try to get him working in a shop some, because he's got to start getting the working skills. That's just so important. Okay, right here. I would not, I can't recommend doctors. I mean, you've got some up in Chicago. All right, what is your problem? Was it a little kid or? Well, the thing is, you do all those brain scans. What are you going to do brain surgery on them? All right, first of all, you got to go, what kind of problem are you trying to fix? His medicines. Okay, well, that is something where once you get out in the hinterlands, that's a real wasteland. There's very, very little thought goes into it. There's way too many antipsychotics being given out. They're horrendous side effects. Okay, first of all, let's just talk about some basic principles of medicines. Try one thing at a time. Don't change his diet or change his school at the same time. A medicine, to make it worth the risk, could have some wow. And when I took the antidepressants, it had a big wow. And be careful switching brands to generics. They're not bioequivalent. I've found that with every drug that I've taken, every drug for any purpose. And be real careful with time-release products. The problem is the generic companies can't copy the manufacturing process, and the time-release things don't work the same way. But what you got to do is really dissect out this medicine thing. And the other problem I've seen is you take with an older client. Maybe he's on two old things, maybe kind of old-fashioned things, and he's real stable. Lots of oftentimes are better off not changing it. I've had doctors trying to change what the ancient old stuff I'm on. Well, if it ain't fixed, ain't broke, why are you going to fix it? I know there's a Dr. Cook up in Chicago that's decent. You know, I hope he's not retired. Cook. I think it's Ed Cook. Why, what kind of problems are you having? So you got different doctors doing different things, and well, the problem is that a lot of this giving medication is sort of controlled experimentation. You know, you carefully try different things. And the mistake that gets made with medication is every time there's a crisis, they just throw stuff at it. Then you end up with somebody with 8 or 9 different things. That's just totally crazy. You got somebody walking around as a drug zombie that can't function. You need to figure out sort of the few things that work. Antidepressants tend to work really well for fear and anxiety. Antipsychotics in low doses can work well for some of the irritability, aggression stuff. Then the epilepsy drugs, they tend to work for rage out of the blue. It's actually a psychomotor seizure, which you're going to have a horrendous time trying to find it. So you might want to just experiment with one of the epilepsy drugs, see if that works, but then you got to do the blood samples here, which is a pain. Then there's the old blood pressure meds, like the beta blockers. They sometimes work well for hot and sweaty rage. Now, I've got the Way I See It book has got a lot of medication stuff in it. There's a new Future Horizons book that's just come out on medication. In fact, there's two books. There's one, I can't remember the title of it. It's on the floor in my bedroom. I can see it, and I can't remember the title. And then they have another one called Hope for the Violently Aggressive Child. And those are two books from Future Horizons that are just on medications. And I'd recommend getting those, plus The Way I See It, second edition. Not the first edition, but the second edition. Okay, right here. So is this 4-year-old, he's injuring himself at home? So when he's sick, he kind of doesn't let you know he's sick. Well, I think another thing is, okay, this is a kid that gets hurt, he doesn't cry. Some of these kids have got a lot of sensory issues. And I think, you know, working with an OT on some of the sensory therapies is part of a good program. Yep, and I think that's part of it. But let's take one more question. My throat's about ready to croak. Okay, how about there in the striped shirt? Well, maybe you better be, because the problem with social situations, I don't do well with just idle social chit-chat. I do a lot better if it's talking with peers that have shared interests. What's your interest? Well, how do you like to talk to people about computer stuff? Well, that's the thing. A lot of people don't want to talk about slaughterhouse stuff, but I find that interesting. Well, I would try to get, you know, in with social peers where there's a shared interest. Maybe, you know, any way you can start working for a computer company or? Well, learn some of all the best programming languages and things like that. The other thing I'm a big believer in is making a portfolio. So instead of trying to sell yourself with an interview, you say, well, look, this is some code I did that can do this, blah, 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 you know, computer talk. And it's something really impressive in a portfolio. You know, if you're good at writing, make a portfolio of some of your writing. Good at art, have it. And you ought to have that on your phone because you never know where you're going to meet somebody you can show that to. Yeah, so you want to short-circuit that interview process. Show that code to somebody that's going to really, you know, appreciate it, that it's really good. Okay, one more quick one there. Overcoming sensory issues. Well, some of the sound sensitivity stuff, you know, you get over that just, you know, where you can initiate it. I still have problems with scratchy clothes. My sensory problems are not the real intense, totally debilitating ones. I mean, there's some kids that never can tolerate going into Walmart. It's just, you know, total, complete meltdown. The squeezing machine, one of the things, the reason why I built the squeezing machine is when I got into puberty, I had all this anxiety. And I found out that the pressure helped calm me down. You know, and there's some individuals that are highly anxious that are pressure seekers. I want to emphasize that does not work on everybody. Another really important thing is tons of exercise. I do 100 sit-ups every night. And if I don't do those 100 sit-ups every night, then I have trouble sleeping. Also, some other things that can help with things like omega-3 supplements. There's getting to be quite a lot of research. Those are helpful. I sometimes take a magnesium supplement when I can't sleep. Sometimes that helps me. It's placebo, but I think it sometimes helps. Okay, well, I want to thank everybody. Thank everybody for coming.
Thank you all for being here, and stay around and ask some questions of Dr. Grandin if you'd like. She'll be down here.